Good evening, Mali. I'm Himsar Aryavansa, a senior member of Wilderness and Wildlife Protection Society of Royal College. So today we are going to present a lecture on seals, one of the most wonderful creatures of the environment. So let's move on. Mali, this is our content. First, we are going to introduce what is a seal and how they hunt, their body composition, how they reproduce, and what are the types of seals, how they communicate, their habitat, their threats, and how they behave, and finally, how to conserve seals. This is our first topic, introduction. Guinea pigs, commonly known as seals, are widely distributed and diverse clade of carnivorous, fin-footed, semi-aquatic marine mammals. Okay. Pinnipeds. Pinniped means a carnivorous semi-aquatic mammal. And semi-aquatic means they must spend some part of their lives on the land as well as in the water. The main habitat of the seals are Antarctic and Arctic. Seals are found in most waters of the world, mainly in the Arctic and Antarctic, but also in some areas of the tropics. Seal is a carnivorous mammal that usually feeds on fish, squid, shellfish, and seabirds, etc. Baby seals are born weighing about 25 pounds, and adult seals weighing about 100 pounds to 4.4 tons. So the average size of a seal is 3 feet to 20 feet long. Average lifespan of a wild seal is up to 30 years. The main predators of the seals are killer whales, polar bears, leopard seals, large sharks, and human beings. Seals are warm-blooded animals. So warm-blooded means they maintain a constant amount of temperature during any environmental condition. So for this, a thick layer of fat called blubber is present in their body. The seals can be divided into two, mainly into two. The earless or true seals and eared seals, which comprise the sea lion and fur seals. So seals process a thick layer of fat below the skin, which provides insulation, act as a food preserve, and contributes to buoyancy. So this thick layer of fat is known as blubber. It's very important for them, which provides insulation and act as a food preserve and to contribute buoyancy. The buoyancy means the ability to float. So in order to float, you need buoyancy. All seals are excellent swimmers and divers. So Mali, this is the scientific classification of seals. Domain Eukarya, Kingdom Animalia, Phylum Chordata, and the class is mammals, order Carnivora. Sande?
Yeah, boys. So the second topic under seals is hunting strategy. So we'll be going through how they find their prey and the specific strategies they use to hunt the hunt their prey. So
Aya, are there seals in Sri Lanka also?
No, Mali. No.
Why is that, Aya?
Because they need cold environment to live.
Oh, okay.
Can you continue?
Yeah, next slide, please. So, common seals mostly forage in shallow coastal waters, usually on the seabed, but occasionally in mid-water. So, they dive in just for a few minutes and they swallow their prey whole, or they bring it up. Like if it's a larger creature, they would just drag it up to shore, and then they'll break them into small pieces, into manageable pieces, and then they'll consume the prey. Next slide. So most of their prey consists of sand eels, cod, herring and bottom dwelling species such as flounder, octopus, and so they need to eat about 4 kilos of food per day. This is about 5% of their body weight. So this is just a rough estimation. So the body weight of a seal, it depends on the environment, and say, so most of the seals live in Antarctica, but seals also live in other parts of the world. So depending on the type of things that are available for them, the overall weight of the seal can change. So the amount of food they consume also can change depending on this. So humans have only recently begun to understand how the seal utilizes its body to find prey and basically hunt the prey. So you see, if you look close into the picture, you'll see like kind of like a beard or like facial hair near their nose. So that this is called whisker. So this is a very sensitive part of their body. So they basically use these whiskers, and they use the vibrations around them to map some kind of area around them. That's how they that's like the main thing they use for, like, to find the prey. So if you take a school of fish, when there's some kind of disruption in the water where they, like, if a lot of fish swim there, there's some kind of disruption, right? So even if a seal is far out with the whiskers, because it's very sensitive, they're able to feel that kind of vibration, and then they follow that, and that's how they find the prey, and then they'll hunt it, and So, next slide. Yeah, Mali, we have a small clip explaining how whiskers work and the importance.
Are able to detect fish because the fish, as they're swimming, leave a wake like a boat, and that hydrodynamic trail is detected by the seal's whiskers. The seal's whiskers are so sensitive that they can pick up those trails from over 100 meters away, and they can do that while they're swimming. The seal's whiskers are not shaped like a drinking straw straight, but are actually undulated, and it's that undulated structure that ensures that the whiskers hardly vibrate even as the seal's swimming, and it allows them to be incredibly sensitive to detecting those trails left by the fish.
Okay, Mali, our third topic is body composition. So, as you can see, the seal's body is streamlined shape. So this streamlined body shape will help them to swim. And they have four flippers, two in front, and two in back. As I told earlier, seals are warm-blooded animals. So they want to maintain a constant amount of temperature in their body in any environmental condition. So this thick layer of blood, which is known as fluke, is present for insulation against cold water. And as Ahani explained, the whiskers, which is very sensitive tactile organ, which helps them to be protect from predators as well as to find food. And seals have pointed teeth at the front, but they doesn't use any of those for chewing. And seals' eyes are very well adapted to see both above and below the water. And their pupils are very similar to the pupils of cats, which is shiny when they hit on light. The body of a typical seal is long and streamlined. Each seal has four flippers, two in front and two in back. The hair covering the seal's entire body is of two types: soft underfur, which insulates the seal against cold when on land, and coastal guard, hair above the under fur, which forms the first line of protection against the cold air temperature. So this coastal guard and the other things are will help them to maintain or regulate their body temperature. Whiskers are located on either side of the mouth, over the eyes, and around the nose, serve as a tactile organ that helps seals to locate food and alert the seals' predator. So these whiskers are very important for them to find food and to be protected from predators. Seals have a thick layer of fat, which is called as blubber, under their skin to keep them warm in icy water. Seals can conserve oxygen for a longer period of time underwater. When the seals start diving, its heart rate slows to about 1/10 of the normal. So this condition will help them to conserve energy. Seals' eyes are well adapted for seeing both above and below the water. So in order to maintain the streamlined shape of the seal, their testicles and mammary glands are located in slits under the skin. So this thing will help to them to maintain their streamlined shape. Seals are able to resist more pain and fatigue caused by lactic acid accumulation than other mammals. So Mali, there's a small video about the body composition of seals for your further understanding.
All pinnipeds have four flippers, a layer of blubber, and sensitive whiskers on their snouts. The harbor seal has all of these and a lot more. Like many marine animals, harbor seals have streamlined fusiform bodies tapered at both ends. Harbor seals have spotty coats. The dorsal side has more spots than the ventral side. To move around, the harbor seal depends on its flippers. The pectoral, or foreflippers, are short and webbed with five bony digits. The digits are about the same length and each has a blunt claw around 1 to 2 inches long. In the water, the foreflippers are used for steering. The webbed hind flippers also have five bony digits, but the outside bones are longer and wider than the inside ones. Moving the hind flippers from side to side propels the harbor seal through the water. Harbor seals are very graceful swimmers, but because their hind flippers don't rotate, they're very clumsy on land. Tucked in between the hind flippers is a short tail. Harbor seals are covered in short, thick hair. Each year after breeding season, they shed their hair in patches. Molting lasts 1 to 2 months. All that hair doesn't keep them warm, however. For that, they rely on their insulating blubber. Harbor seals are endothermic animals. They control their body temperature by burning internal fuel, which in turn keeps them warm. Harbor seals have a mouthful of teeth, but they don't use any of them for chewing. Their front teeth are sharp and pointed and great for grasping and tearing. Back molars are used for crushing the shells of crustaceans and mollusks. Being a pinniped, the harbor seal can open and close its nostrils. When the nose muscles are relaxed, the nostrils are closed and airtight. The lenses in their eyes are adapted for focusing on refracted light in the water. Their pupils are similar to cat's pupils, opening wide in dim light and closing to slits when it's bright. They also have a reflective membrane that makes their eyes glow when hit with light, just like cat's eyes. Instead of ear flaps, harbor seals have an external ear opening to the ear canal. It opens and closes when they dive. They have good hearing above and below the water, but respond to sound better in air. The whiskers are called vibrissae, and each vibrissa moves independently. The vibrissae are very sensitive to movement and can detect the smallest vibrations. These signals help with navigation and in finding food, especially in dark water and at night when vision is limited. All of these parts working together make the harbor seal one amazing marine mammal.
So the fourth topic is reproduction. I'm pretty sure all of you all know what reproduction is, but I'll explain it anyways. So reproduction is very important for the survival of any species, because it's the process of how the life form of a specific species carried on. So this is actually very important for the survival of any species. When we talk about sexual maturity, most male seals become mature when they reach a certain weight. It's about 75 kilos and 165 lbs. And they reach this certain weight between 3 and 7 years. And with females, they usually become mature when they reach a weight about 50 kilos. And this is approximately 110 lbs. And just as the males, it takes usually 3 to 6 years for them to reach the maximum maturity. And I'll move on to mating activities. So mating season varies among the subspecies, but generally occurs in late spring through fall. You guys know what the four seasons are. So the seasons go, it goes from summer and then fall, winter and spring. So the mating season usually starts in spring. So it goes from spring and then summer through fall. So when females come into estrus, usually about 6 weeks after their pups are born, females remain in estrus for 1 to 9 weeks. Seals usually return to the same breeding grounds every year. So if you say if it's Antarctica, it's the most populated place for seals. So they in Antarctica, it's a very large continent. If there's a certain group of seals, they return to the same breeding grounds every year, just like the generation above them. Yeah. Next slide. So prior to pupping season, males and females exhibit pre-mating activities such as growling, bubble blowing, and mouthing each other's necks. The pre-mating behavior ends with the beginning of the pupping season. During the mating season, male seals exhibit underwater vocal displays during short dives, which are probably associated with mating. These displays take place near haul-out sites, foraging areas and travel routes between two areas, and also increase during times that females are more likely to be in the water. After the pupping season, males initiate true mating behavior by chasing, neck and flipper biting, and embracing. When approached, females respond by growling, head thrusting, and flipper waving. Copulation usually takes place underwater, and usually male seals may even mate with several female seals. This is the kind of reproductive behavior that seals show. We'll move on to the next one.
Mali, types of seals. There are 32 species or types of seals on the planet. So, for example, if you take dogs, there are different types or species of dogs, such as Labradors, Golden Retrievers. So, likewise, seals also have different types or species. Example, Herb Seal, Harbor Seals are some of them. So, there are 32 species or types of seals on the planet. The largest is the Southern Elephant Seal, which can weigh more than 2 tons, and the smallest is the Galapagos fur seal, which weighs 65 pounds. So the largest is the South Elephant Seal, and the smallest fellow is the Galapagos fur seal. The most common type of seal is the Harbor Seal. Most common type of seal is Harbor Seal. So they differ from one another from their size and the shape of the pupil. Ring seals are the most endangered seal species. So different types of seals, the most common types are Herb Seals, Gray Seal, Caspian Seal, Harbor Seal, the most common type, and the Ribbon Seal. So there are some pictures. This is Herb Seal, the Gray Seal, Caspian Seal, Harbor Seal, Ribbon Seal. So
Yeah, this is actually one of the most interesting parts about seals, the way they communicate. I'm sure most of you all have been to water parks and if you go to water park, you usually see dolphin shows, you usually see seal shows. Even in cartoons, you might have seen seals playing with a ball. Yeah, and you might have heard them out, like the kind of sounds they make. It's we'll move on to the next slide. So all kinds of seals communicate vocally by making noise with their throat and air. The range and pitch and the variety of these noises, however, are all vast. So harbor seals make certain noises with their mouth, like with their throat and air. So the pitch and the range is what works as words. It's like dogs use different pitches of barking to communicate between dogs. Like we use words. The words have different pitches and different ranges. And so the way the seals use this is they go underwater and they have different mechanisms in their throat that supports this kind of change in pitch and in their throat. So Arctic seals can grow. Arctic seals usually groan, chug or growl in the course of their communication. Weddell seals send out long, low whistles underwater at very high decibel levels. And harbor seals make quiet calls. So you can see that different types of seals make different, use different kinds of ways to communicate between themselves. The variation of these methods show the highly specified development of their species of seals in response to its environment. Each style of communication suits a particular need. Yeah, next slide.
So, Mali, any questions after him? Habitat. So habitat, what is habitat? Habitat means the place or the environment where animals naturally or normally live and grow. So for seals, their habitat is Arctic Ocean and Antarctic Ocean. So I just keep. Seals typically live in cold ocean waters of Arctic or off the coast of Antarctica. Some seals make caves in the snow to live. Others never leave the ice pack and poke breathing holes in the ice. Seals doesn't go to land often, so they doesn't go home. Sometimes seals swim all the way to Greenland because of shortage of food supply. So if there's a condition such as a shortage of food supply, they seals swim all the way to Greenland to satisfy their food need. So resting seals, the sites of seals may be mudflats, rocky coasts, or sandy beaches. Seals may spend several days so to satisfy their food need, they travel up to 50 kilometers per day. 50 kilometers per day. And seals mostly live where there is plenty of salt water. So seals are marine animals, so they love to live the places where plenty of salt water. They tend to live in environments where they won't be disturbed by humans or other predators. So they love to live in environments which is free from predators. Some species are migratory. Others can be found moving from their natural habitat, though if the conditions are wrong there. For example, when the water has been polluted or there is a shortage of food for them to survive. So normally some species are migrated, but others are not. So if there is a special condition, like the water has been polluted or there's a shortage of food, they will migrate. They enjoy land that has rocks and that is close to the water. So, Mali, according to the habitat, seals can be divided into two groups, Arctic seal and Antarctic seal. Arctic seals are the seals who live in Arctic Ocean, and Antarctic seals are the seals who live in Antarctic Ocean. So mainly six species are living in Arctic Ocean: herp seals, hooded seals, ring seals, barbet seals, spotted seals, ribbon seals are some seal species who live in Arctic Ocean, and others are living in Antarctic Ocean. So mainly you can find only four species in Antarctic, but there are many more individual seals in Arctic than Antarctic. So main four species are leopard seals, rose seals, and etc. I just read this slide. Although only four species of seals are found in Antarctica, there are many more individual seals in Antarctica than in Arctic.
Yes, Mali. The next topic under seals is threats. I wanted to make this slide interactive, actually. So you guys know what global warming and the effects of global warming, right? I think you all learn in school as well, in your lectures in school, about global warming. So can somebody explain what global warming is?
Yeah, it's the temperature rising in this world.
Yes, Mali. It yeah, that is the main cause of global warming.
Cutting down of trees and deforestation and environmental pollution.
Yeah, yeah. All of these examples that you're told are they're all right. So these are all effects that the global warming. So most of these seals living in Antarctica,
even the
right?
even the sea levels rise because of it, because the icebergs melt.
Mm-hmm. That's excellent. So that's like the main threat seals have from global warming, because if the sea levels rise, then they will have no habitat, they will have no land. So no, and this they of course can swim, but they can't live by themselves. There is a certain thing called ecosystem. So the ecosystem is what holds a whole group of species, not just seals, a whole group of species together. So if the if there are effects on other animals, it indirectly affects the seals as well, because no species can live by itself. It always depends on something else. So yeah, Malik. Can someone tell me like 2-3 ways how we can manage global warming and how we can stop global warming, basically? What we can do to stop global warming?
We recycle more?
Yes, yes. We recycling is a very important factor in trying to stop global warming.
Planting trees, trees.
Do not pollute.
Yeah.
Using less hot waters.
That's not exactly right, Mali. But the idea is not wrong. So if we reduce the carbon dioxide usage, that is a way to slow down global warming. Any more ideas, ma'am?
Reducing risk from rising sea levels.
Yes, yes. That is absolutely right, ma'am.
Basically, and plant trees.
Yeah. Yeah, so if we take, you guys know what, you guys know about the ship that sank in near Sri Lanka, right?
Yes, sir, yeah.
Yeah, so when that
Express
ship, Pearl. Yeah, Express Pearl. When that ship ship sank, so basically, like a lot of chemicals got into the seawater, and then it disrupted the lifestyle of fish. And if the fish die, there'll be no prey for seals. And so you understand how killing off one species affects another. Do you guys get that?
Yes,
how it's an ecosystem and not just one species.
The food chain will break out.
Yeah.
So, what you mean is when the fish die, the seals will starve to death. Then whatever's eating the seals will starve to death. And then whatever eats that starves to death.
Yes, exactly. That is absolutely right. So, I'll move on to the next slide. Another main reason, another main threat on seals is hunting. So each year thousands of seals get killed by hunting. Excuse me, Molly, please. Everyone, please mute yourself. Thank you. Okay, so. One of the biggest threats on seals from humans is hunting. So throughout the year, thousands of seals get killed because of hunting, because of trophy hunting and just various levels of hunting. And because of the careless mistakes that we do, animals have to pay. Like if you take that, if you take the same thing, if you take the Express World incident as an example, the chemicals that went into the sea, if the fish, if the seals consume anything with that chemicals, it could disrupt their whole body and it could disrupt the functioning of their body. So you understand how most of the threats that come on these animals, it's directly or indirectly comes to humans. It becomes a fault of the humans, directly or indirectly. So as the younger generation, you guys have to start from now onwards to start saving this planet, because all these issues are very crucial for our future. So I'll move on to the next slide. So, the seal hunt is one of the very few hunts that occurs in the spring when young are being born. As a result, roughly 80% of the seals killed in the commercial hunt are young of the year, between approximately 12 days and 1 year old. Younger seals are usually killed on the ice with clubs or pack picks. Later in the season, beaters and older seals are usually shot with rifle, both on ice and in water. It is also legal to use shotgun firing slugs. It is illegal to deliberately capture seals using nets, although seals are often caught incidentally in nets set for other fisheries. In 2002, 75% of seal pups died due to lack of ice in this condition due to global warming. So you see, from this, you can understand the indirect effect global warming has on seals and their future. And so we have to stop this. As the younger generation, you all have to make a change starting from now. Yeah, we'll move on to the next slide.
Oh my God!
Yeah, Mali, that was a very clear example of how global warming affects seals and the species around it, every all aquatic species and basically every kind of species in the world. So what happened in this video is because of global warming, the glaciers got heated up and they started melting and collapsing. And then when they collapse, the sea level rises. You guys get that, right? If you drop a bunch of ice into a water bottle, the water level rises, right? It's the same thing in just a very large scale way. So when the sea level rises, it disrupts the disrupts land and their habitats. Yeah, Mal. Yeah, we'll move on to the next.
Our ninth topic is behavior. So normally seals are highly intelligent marine mammals. So they perform complex behavior in both marine and terrestrial environment. They perform very complex behavior in the terrestrial and marine habitat. So I just read, seals generally do not touch each other. They maintain a space between them of a meter or more. So they normally maintain a space between them. While on land, seals rarely move from one location. They remain alert and turn their heads frequently to watch for potential danger. When alarmed, seals quick rush into the water. So while on land, they being alert about their predator. So if they feel threatened, they quick rush into the water. Seals rarely interact with other species, but show aggression if threatened. So normally they rarely react with other species, but they show aggressions if threatened. Aggressions such as scratching, biting, flipper waving, and head thrusting are some of aggression that show towards other species if they feel threatened. And seals can sleep both in water and the land. Make it easier for them to choose whatever the best for their situation to avoid danger. So to avoid danger and to be protected from other predators, they can sleep both in water and the land. Normally, seals happily rest for hours on chosen. So they normally rest on big rocks and they wait until next high tide flows them off. So these are some pictures how seals behave in the land as well as in a marine habitat. As you can see, they maintain a distance between them and how they react with other species if they threaten, and how they sleep both in terrestrial environment as well as in marine environment.
Yes, Mali. The 10th slide we have is how to conserve seals. So this is also directly connected with global warming and all these effects on seals and how to conserve. So yeah, we'll move on to the next one. So Mali, seals right now are not classified as extremely endangered species for now. But the way humans are responding to global warming and climate change, I'm sure in the near future, they will become endangered. So because of various things that humans do, actually. So if you take like things like burning fossil fuels. So burning fossil fuels is a very harmful effect on climate change. And cutting down trees and farming livestock. All of these examples are very harmful effects on global warming. And it also affects the ozone layer. You guys will learn about the ozone layer and the kind of effects it has on the atmosphere in the future. So all these things, these lead up to greenhouse gases. I think y'all might know what greenhouse gases are. So basically these are gases like carbon and nitrogen. So basically they just interrupt the behavior and the ecosystems that were built a long time ago. So, Yamali, anyone want to add to anything that I'm saying about global warming and how y'all can make a difference in this? Mal. Okay, so we'll move on to the last slide, Mali, and then we'll discuss. Yeah.
Mali, any questions?
No, I have.